we are, we're putting together, or we have put together, what we call the protocol for, or the guidelines for switching your grip. If you're watching this, you probably decided, hey, I want to give the overlap grip a shot. And these gentlemen right here, call out your name.
So. Gary Winton.
Chuck Torgler.
Gary Benton.
All these guys we have together, and behind the camera is Phil Farmer, and Dan Carlson just went off to get our screen because we got a screen, but one of the parts are missing. So we are the group that's here today in the Art of Hitting Club. We have hundreds of years, over 100 years of experience using overlap grip, and we've come up with this as a group. So the number one thing is that you have to be committed to doing this, and for your own reason. We're not suggesting that you should do it. Everybody hits different ways. The overlap grip, from the previous video, if you watched it, has helped a lot of people. We don't need to go into that. So be committed and believe that it will help you. That's the start. And the number two thing,
a rubber bat knob at the end of the bat and batting gloves.
Gary, you want to talk to that?
Well, I mean, you know, it's the knob cup is for, we look right here.
Yeah.
When most people that go to an overlap grip, they're going to take the bat and they're going to sit in the middle of their palm right there. So this, if you don't have some type of transition from the bat to the actual knob itself, that's going to start cutting into the flesh, and over time it's going to, you might develop calluses. Maybe you're a hardworking guy where it doesn't bother you, but most people look all the little discomfort in your swing. So just put something on there to help with that transition. It can be a knob cuff. You can sit there and use tape and wrap around it to where it helps that transition from the handle to the knob.
This is a piece that I think we forgot, Dan. What was the main thing we forgot? It should be in number two.
When you first transition into the overlap grip from this, it's going to hurt the middle of your hand. You're going to have to either build calluses up, or my recommendation is to change the batting gloves you use. Gary Benton uses work gloves. This is a different kind of work glove, and you can see from where I hold the bat that it makes a little groove in there. If you use just a regular game batting glove that's really thin, it has a good feel to it, it's going to tear here. So expect when you transition into the overlap grip that it might hurt a little bit, but you can help yourself a lot by changing it to a work glove.
Well, that doesn't necessarily have to be a work glove. You know, they make gloves like that. The work gloves are cheaper.
I've bought the batting gloves with the padding.
Yeah.
They don't last as long as a work glove.
Right. The work glove, you can get.
Might be true. That might be true.
20 at Costco.
Yeah, well, you can get 3 for 20. I agree. I see guys wearing that. But if you want to be stylish and want to wear, they do make batting gloves with that thing. Franklin makes the best one with, but that padding right there is, I guess it's what you use for a hammer. But yeah, a lot of guys use work gloves. That's how you got all your money, man. You saving $5 on a work glove.
That's it. And Ed Rose doesn't charge me for the balls I hit him.
Yeah, but you owe me, man.
And number three is just to have a minimum of 200 swings before the game.
Okay. Who wants to explain that? You guys, you want to explain it?
That's fine. Yes, the concept of 200 swings, because you'll have ups and downs. You know, sometimes you'll think you're doing well with it, and other times you'll think this is not working. You got to at least get 200 swings in to even start thinking about using this on a consistent basis.
Okay. And the other part of that, which Terry's not familiar with, and I'll take that, is that there's a 20 time rule. Use it, and once you've done that, taking the 200 swings, you want to use it in 20 straight games. You say, why 20? Well, when I was in the corporate world as a training manager, I taught a habits class, how you break a habit. And those of you who have bad habits, you want to break a habit, this is the way to do it. For example, the seat belt. I never wore my seat belt. And I was teaching in a class. If you did a habit like put your seatbelt on every time you get in the car 20 times in a row, now it'll become a permanent habit. And hey, it did. And to this day, I can't get in the car without putting my seatbelt on. So it's called the 20 time rule. 20 games in a row, you should be set. And number four. What's number four?
Number four is once you start, stay with it.
It's
be committed to, don't give up on it. As Terry was saying, is that, you know, you got to have a, do it at least 20 times. But if you stay, you stay committed to it, and you, you just you have to use it. You have to get your confidence in that grip. Dan,
put it down. Come over here. We'll finish this. Something important.
Dan Carlson, okay. All-star of Melbourne.
Now we got to cut this piece out, man.
What? Dan Carlson, the all-star.
Yeah, well, yeah. Okay.
Touch elbows. Man. Touch all elbows. Right. All right, number five is keep your hands strong.
Okay, who wants to talk about that? Dan, you just came up. We're running out of it. What? How? Why is it important to keep your hands strong?
Good control of the bat, and any part of your body that can be stronger, that's always better.
Maybe you could tell us how you get forearms like that. Look at him in pain.
Well, you know what I do? I don't even know if anybody else does this.
This is a family channel. Everybody knows that joke.
Keep it a PG.
A 10-pound plate on a string with a broken hockey stick, and I roll it up, and I roll it down, and it's always kept my forearm strong.
Broken hockey stick. Amazing. He must have played hockey. So what's the sixth one? I think we keep it at six, right?
All right, number six is change to a lighter bat.
Everyone's had one, right? Change to a lighter bat. Yeah. Why should you change to a lighter bat? Well, you don't have to. Just a recommendation. Okay, and you guys chime in if there's something you want to add to this.
With your strong hands and that, and you go to a lighter bat, you got more control of the bat to keep the bat through the zone where you're looking at to hit the ball. If your hands are weak and the bat's too heavy, your bat's going to dip. So you're not going to swing level, and you're going to miss hit the ball by a quarter inch, then you're just going to pop up. My opinion.
That's a little bat speed.
Well, the switching to the grip increases your bat speed already, and if you go to a lighter bat, it increases it more, won't it?
Yeah,
it does, and everything. But what really the concept is and everything, when I got two hands on the bat like this, I've got plenty of control of that bat head, this here area here and everything. When I go through the zone, I can control that a little much better. As I start taking fingers off, I drop one finger off, two fingers off, three fingers off, until I get to a full overlap grip. If I'm using a heavy bat, let's say a 28, well, maybe now and everything, maybe I had control with both hands, but when I drop here, my lever is this small instead of being this tall. So I've got less bat in my hands, and it's harder to control, and that's what Chuck is talking about, where that bat head, when you go through, it might dip because you can't control it, because you don't have the wrist strength built up yet. And really just the mechanics to do it. So it's just really how much of the bat you have in your hand and how much control you have over the bat.
Before I moved to Florida, I was swinging 28-ounce in Canada, and that was my best. I was using the overlap grip. The first senior bat I had here was a 26.5 end load, and the senior bat itself was amazing, so I kind of stayed with it. And I like the end load part of it too, because I do like the extra, the weight of the bat. You can balance bats. I like the end load, but now I've tried the 28 ounce again, and I feel much slower. I didn't think so before, but now that I spent some time with the 26.5 end load, going back to a 28 ounces, I wouldn't consider that.
So let's recap this. We got 6 points, right, guys? The first one was decide, right? Decide and be committed, right?
Yep. Commit to it.
Commit to it. And number two, the knob, right?
Knob.
Yeah.
Or having some type of transition from the handle to the knob of the bat.
And number three was, what are you going to do before you use it in a game?
Minimum 200 swings. Get used to it.
Good.
In a game.
Good. Okay. And then when you get in a game, what's the 20 times rule?
Change a habit.
Change a habit. It's going to take you 20 games, and you should be committed. Do you guys feel that in your experience? Did you? Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Definitely.
Okay. And then number four was, once you start,
don't stop.
Stay with it.
Don't stop.
Because Gary, you made this point last night, right? Because you are going to go bad, right?
Absolutely. You're going to fail before you succeed, and that's just because you've changed your mechanics. Anytime you change your mechanics, it kind of goes back to that 20-time rule that you were discussing. we got to build that muscle memory before we can actually focus on it. We got to be able to do it without thinking about it. If we're thinking about our mechanics, we're not thinking about hitting that ball that's coming at us, even though it's coming at us at 10 miles an hour. It's still, we have to focus totally on that ball if we want to hit it well, and you can't do that when you're focused on your mechanics.
And then the fifth one is keep your
hands strong.
And then the six was, you know, change the lighter bat, and we talked about that, but the one thing that we didn't mention was the MOI, the moment of inertia. Yeah. Gary, you want to speak a little bit to that?
Well, I think that has a lot to do with the way bats are loaded, the inload. If most senior bats, I mean, obviously they have the balanced bats out there, but if you swing an inloaded bat, a lot of them are extremely inloaded. So you may be used to swinging a 28-ounce balanced bat. You go to a senior bat that's got a full ounce inload, you're going to probably want to drop down because a 26 is probably going to swing just like a 28, if not even heavier. So that makes a big difference, because that inload is what's going to create that bat whip, and that's what we want to generate bat speed. That bat whip and everything's just going to get through there. If you can control it, it's going to sit there and really create that moment of inertia that you're mentioning, in my opinion, I think, and you're going to get a lot more performance out of it.
Now, you know, that's the six steps. There's one thing that we didn't have in here. How important is muscle memory? Who wants to talk about muscle memory?
You can't be thinking when you do it. You have to, this is where you do the muscle memory testing, your batting practice, whatever. When you step into a batter's box in the game, you can't be thinking about your mechanics. You just got to be, it's done well when you practice, and then when you get into a game, it's still done.
So what you're saying is muscle memory comes from practice.
Perfect practice, yes.
What?
Perfect practice.
Is that one of Bob's deal? It sounds like it's coined. Does Bob say that, perfect practice?
Yeah, perfect practice.
Well, and that goes with you. He's a great coach. And the deal is, right, practice has you play. Ask Phil Farmer there. That boy won't swing at a ball in practice.
And it helps when you have good pitchers. That's all I'm going to say.
I think that's a dig. We're going to leave it like that. I hope this video helps you. Anything to add, guys, for to go to people that might look at this and know that they got this information from the three most handsomest guys? There's four of you there. I better say four.
Well, the one thing, all six of these things, once you accomplish them, they all come together as one at the end. You're not thinking the other. They all come together and meld to one at the end.
Okay, guys. Thanks a lot.
All
right.
Thanks.
I pay my dues. Time after time. I've done my sentence, but committed no crime. And bad mistakes, I've made a few. I've had my share.